Assalamualaikum and hi everyone. Today we will continue with part 2 of chapter 1, Introduction to Power Electronics. Okay, in the previous video we have covered the definition of power electronics. So today we will continue with electronic switches followed by a brief of power electronics applications. Okay, as mentioned in the previous video, an electronic switch has two states only, on and off state. Okay, so either it is short circuit or open circuit. And we are using the switching device because of its low power dissipation. Alright, so for the on state, the switch must be closed or short circuit so that current can flow through it. Okay, while for the off state, the switch must be open. So therefore, no current can flow through the switch. Okay, next, electronic switches can be categorized into three groups. So here we have uncontrolled, semi-controlled, and fully controlled switch. Alright, so for the uncontrolled switch, the on and off state can be controlled using power circuit. An example for the uncontrolled switch is power diode or a diode. So this is a symbol for the diode. And then for the semi-control, the on state can be controlled by low power control signal, but we cannot turn off the switch from outside since its off state is controlled by power circuit only. Alright, so example for the semi-control is thyristor. Okay, so for the thyristor, it includes SCR, triac, and MCT. And finally, for the fully controlled, as the name implies, it can be turned on and off by low power control signals. Alright, so examples for the fully controlled are BJT, MOSFET, IGBT, GTO, and IGCT. Okay, now let's talk about an uncontrolled device or switch first. Okay, so a diode is the simplest electronic switch. Okay, so this is the symbol for the diode. Okay, and it is a two terminal PN junction device. Okay, and it is uncontrollable. Okay, so why it is uncontrollable? It is uncontrollable because the on and off conditions are determined by voltage and current in the circuit only. Okay. Okay, there are two conditions for the diode, forward bias and reverse bias. Now, let's discuss the forward bias first. Okay, so to bias a diode, we need to apply a DC voltage across the PN junction here. Okay, then a P-type region must be connected to the positive terminal of the source, while the N-type region must be connected to the negative terminal. Alright, so with a battery connected this way, the holes in the P-type region and the electrons in the N-type region are pushed towards the junction and start to neutralize the region here, which in turn reducing its width. Okay, so as you can see here that the depletion region is now narrowed. Alright, so as a result, an electron can flow across the junction, right? So electron can flow across the junction, but we need to make sure that our applied voltage here is larger than the barrier potential. So for example, if you use silicon, so it must be larger than 0.7 volts. Okay, in other words, if terminal A has a higher potential compared to terminal K, so diode will start conducting. Okay, and then a forward current will flow from A to K. So this is what we call as a forward bias condition. Okay, now let's move on to the reverse bias condition. So again, we need to apply a DC voltage across the PN junction here. Okay, but then for the P-type region, it must be connected to the negative terminal, while for the N-type region, it must be connected to the positive terminal of the source. Alright, so by connecting this way, the holes in the P-type region and electrons in the N-type region are pulled away from the junction. Okay, so it will leave behind charged ions and causing the width of the depletion region to increase. Okay, so now we can see here that the depletion region is becoming wider, alright, and this will increase the voltage barrier, causing a high resistance to the flow of charge carriers, and the junction now behave as an insulator. Okay, therefore a very minimal current can cross the PN junction now, alright. So for the reverse bias condition, actually the voltage at the K here is comparatively higher than at the A, okay, because of the polarity here. Therefore, a very little current can flow until the diode breaks down. But this is true for the practical diode only. But for the ideal diode, we can assume that no current flow during reverse bias condition. Okay, an important dynamic characteristic of a non-ideal diode is the reverse recovery current. Okay, so when diode turns off, the current decreases and momentarily becomes negative before return to zero. Alright, so the moment from here to here is known as a reverse recovery time, or TRR. Okay, and it is given by T1 plus T2. Okay, and the effects of reverse recovery are increase in switching losses, increase in voltage rating, and it may produce overvoltage or spike in inductive loads. Okay, so that's why we always want a smaller TRR. Okay, and a fast recovery diodes are designed to have smaller TRR than diode designed for line frequency applications. Alright. Okay, power diode can be divided into three types. So here we have line frequency or general purpose diode, fast recovery diode, and Schottky diode. Okay, so among these three, the line frequency diode has the highest voltage and current rating, while for the Schottky diode, it has a very low reverse recovery time, or TRR, which is given in nanosecond. Okay, so that it has very low turn off time and it has a very high switching frequency. Okay, so that it is very good, but still it is depends on our applications. Okay, now let's move on to the semi-controlled device, where the switch turn on can be controlled but not the turn off time. Alright, so example for the semi-controlled device is thyristor. Okay, so the term thyristor often refers to a family of three terminal device. Okay, so we have anode, cathode, and gate. That includes the SCR, triac, GTO, MCT, and etc. Okay, so the thyristor and SCR are terms that are sometimes used synonymously, right? So in this class, the SCR will be used to illustrate the semi-controlled device of the thyristor family. Okay, so for the SCR to start conducting, it must have an external gate current applied here, while it has a positive anode to cathode voltage, or VAK. Alright, so the SCR will continue to conduct as long as the anode current remain positive and above a minimum value called the holding value. Alright, so here is the waveform for the circuit with SR. Okay, so as you can see here, there is no output voltage until we inject the gate current during the positive half cycle here. Okay, so this is the positive half cycle. So once we inject the gate current here, so we will get the output voltage of this circuit. Okay, the SCR cannot be turned off by applying negative current. SCR will be only turned off when anode current, or IA, goes negative or reverse. Okay, so this happens during natural commutation when the waveform here goes to negative. Okay, and then another method to turn off the SCR is by forced commutation, where the IA is diverted to another circuitry. Okay, so advantages of thyristor or SCR is it has a lower on-state connection loss, high power handling capability, and high voltage and current rating. So that's why it is still used in high power application, but the switching frequency is not high as the MOSFET, right? Okay, now let's talk about a fully controlled device. So here we have power transistors. Okay, so a transistor can be used as an amplifier or as a switch. But in power electronics, it is used as a switch as it can be turned on and turned off by a very small control signal. Okay, and it is current control device as we need to give a continuous base or gate current here to keep it in the conducting state. Okay, and the transistor drive circuits are designed to have the transistor either in the fully on or fully off state. So either it is in saturation or cutoff condition. And the voltage and current ratings of power transistor are much lower than the thyristors. Therefore, it is used in low to medium power applications. Okay, here are the fully controlled device where we have BJT, MOSFET and IGBT. Okay, so for the BJT, we need to inject a base current or base voltage here to turn on the BJT. Okay, but then when there is no voltage present, the switch will be turned off. Okay, and the BJT is used for power converter that less than 10 kHz, but nowadays, it is rarely used as it has been replaced by MOSFET and IGBT. Okay, and then for the MOSFET, we need to inject a gate voltage here to turn on the MOSFET. And this is same with the IGBT. Okay, but then to turn off the switch or the MOSFET or IGBT, we need to connect it to the ground. Okay, and for the MOSFET, the switching speed is greater than BJT and it is used in converters that operates in megahertz range. While for the IGBT, it is faster than BJT but slower than MOSFET and it is used for high voltage converter. Okay, power electronic circuits are widely used in our daily lives. It has emerged as a complex and multidisciplinary technology after several decades. From home appliance to transportation, heavy industry, electric power generation and transmission, and even in the space technology. So in brief, not only to convert electrical power from one form to another form, power electronics is also a key technology for a better modern life and plays an important role in solving global warming. That is why power electronics is very important. And here is the reference that I use for this slide. Okay, so with that, I thank you. Bye-bye.